Modern cars are powered by all sorts of forms of hydrocarbons because they can run on diesel, on petrol, they can run on compressed natural gas or liquefied petroleum gas, they can run on pure ethanol or a composition between gasoline and ethanol, they can also use biodiesel, which is in a sense essentially cooking oil, but you can also have a combination with diesel. And these combinations are called E85, for example, for gasoline, where 85% of that fluid is ethanol and 15% is gasoline. And you can also have B7, B10, B15, B20, B30, where, for example, in a B30, 70% is diesel and 30% is that biodiesel stuff, which is actually artificial. And some of the cars run purely electrical, and some of them, like this one, are hybrids, and not any form of hybrid, but a plug-in hybrid. So it means that they use a conventional engine. Germans like to use especially gasoline engines, but also diesel in some variants. Mercedes has this system. And they are completed by, complemented actually, by an electrical motor, which is placed usually in the transmission, because German cars do like to use the parallel hybrid system. So this car here, it's called a BMW X-Drive 30E. So it means that its total power output is 292 horsepower, 420 newton meters, and the whole system is composed of a B48 gasoline engine that on its own develops 184 horsepower and 300 newton meters. It's the exact same engine, 2-liter inline 4 turbo direct injection, that is used on the 20i specification model, same rating, horsepower and torque. And this system is complemented by an electrical motor that is placed instead of the torque converter of the ZF-HP transmission. So you have a normal transmission housing, but inside that housing you get an electrical motor that is shaped like a pot, which on the outside part, glued to the case of the transmission, you have an electromagnet called a stator, which can be energized with a three-phase alternating current that is drawn from a 12 kilowatt-hour battery through an inverter that converts the DC electrical power output of the battery to an AC power output for the motors. And that rotor of the engine contains permanent magnets, so that rotor encases the space where the former torque converter used to be and acts like one, but also can power the car purely electrical using all the transmission speeds, so 8 speeds for reverse, for forward motion, and 1 speed for reverse. And it can also run as a hybrid. So for example, the gasoline engine powers the transmission through that motor through a separating clutch, and every time the engine moves the wheels, it also moves the rotor of the electrical motor. But if you don't energize the stator of that motor, the rotor only spins as an empty component, so it does not generate or use electricity. And when the hybrid system kicks in, the stator begins to be powered by that inverter and begins to develop power together with the engine. And they are linked to the transmission and to a transfer case, which can power all four wheels at the same time, being an X-drive system. And if you want the car to run purely electrical, the system switches the engine off and decouples the transmission from the engine, from the electrical motor, by that clutch. So what you get is basically a ZF-8HP transmission that has its own motor instead of that torque converter. Kind of a complicated system, but it actually works, because this car has the same fuel consumption as a normal 3-liter inline 6 diesel with 286 horsepower, and the same consumption as a 2-liter inline 4 30i, which develops around 265 horsepower. Both systems are mild hybrids, the gasoline and the diesel, but this being a plug-in hybrid is more versatile. So you get to run about 40 kilometers electric range, and the total range of the fuel tank, 50 liters, together with a battery full, you get around 500, 600 kilometers depending on the way you drive. So these are the spec numbers. Let's look inside the car to see a beautiful Vernasca leather interior with a mocha coffee color and a bit around the car, because I think it is the best proportioned SUV from BMW. The front grille is not that big and the proportions of the car are very well balanced without it sticking it to your eyes that it is an aggressive design. I think it's a normal calculated design, but especially during this video, what's left of it, of course, another 10 minutes or so, we will talk about the engine and its technical specifications and what parts are under the hood, so that you curious people will know more about your cars, because I'm sure that some of you own this exact specification of car, maybe they own this type of engine on another BMW and are just simply curious of what components these engines have. So stick around if you want to find out more. So this being a test drive car, which is from BMW Romania, the country where I live in Bucharest more exactly, and it is a car that is very well spec'd. Its price is 80,000 euros, but without the cost cutting deductions from the state. So you actually can buy this car probably at 65, maybe 70,000 euros as a price. Yes, it is an expensive car because it is a premium one. So you get BMW laser lights, you can equip it with up to 21 inch wheels, you get an M-Pack styling for the exterior and interior, you get digital assistance systems, navigation system with big large screens inside, which are also vocally operated, or you can use a controller or a touchscreen system. Even if it is a plug-in eco-friendly vehicle, I like that it has real exhaust, which also have a flap, and the overall design is quite nice, and the optional extras list is very, very long, so that's why the base price of this model is about 52,000 euros. You get 180 18D, 20D, 30D and M40D as diesel engines. The first three are B47 inline 4 with different states of tune and the settings of the turbines. And the former two, the 30D, actually the first two, sorry for the mistake, 18D and 20D are inline 4s, B47s, and 30D and M40D are diesels that are inline 6, but they use different kind of turbos, one with a variable geometry and one normally for the 30D, and both with variable geometry for M40D. And gasoline-wise, you have 20i, 30i, which are the same engine but with different mechanical setups inside them, so you get 184 or around 250 or so horsepower. And then you get the M40i, which is an inline 6 B58 engine with around 360 horsepower. And this is a different kind of car, which I already explained as spec-wise, because it is a plug-in hybrid model, so that's why you have a small boot, because the battery resides under the seat and the whole electronical part and the fuel tank is situated around here, so that's why you get around only 415 liters, but it is a quite modular system because you have all sorts of depositing spaces here, and the backrests can be folded separately or totally, and you get electrical closing of the boot. You can also use your leg like a Maradona football system, but I don't quite use that system because I never got it to work. The inside is very nice, soft materials around, only this part is hard plastic, which on a 5 series you'll encounter as being soft. This part is also leather, has the seats. You can have cloth, a Sensatec, which is kind of a fake leather, and you get Vernasca or Merino leather, and some of them are also with Alcantara equipment, and some seats are perforated so they have ventilation. And I think the color is very nice, you get a lot of room, triple zone climate control, so you get a separate climate function in the back. And in the front part, the electrical seats have around 14 adjustment setups, because you get 10 adjustments here. Also the headrest is electrically mounted, and you get the pneumatical bolsters here, which are controlled by this button, and this button is for the massage function and for the lumbar support, and this portion extends mechanically. And the same goes for the driver's side, but there you have memory buttons, so you can set up two profiles that are anyway linked to the key. You get nice screens there because this has a digital cockpit professional, not a digital cockpit live. That is a lower spec setup, so we have big screens that have good connectivity. I think it is a perfect system because you can control the system by voice, and you also have a touch screen, but you also have that magical controller, the iDrive 7 system, which can be used as a handwriting system, where you can just, I don't know, switch between those modes, and I find it very, very practical and ready to use. Heated seats, ventilated on some options, steering wheel is heated, also an M-Pack, so that's just about it regarding the inside of the car. You have to pull this latch twice and you can open the hood, so let's see the interesting engine. You don't get that twin power turbo system, but an e-drive spec, because this is a plug-in hybrid. But actually the motor itself, the engine, actually the motor is the electrical part. It is a B47 engine, B48, sorry, because the B47 is a diesel, inline 4, direct injected twin scroll turbocharged engine with Vanos and Valvetronic system that develops 184 horsepower and 300 Newton meters. So this engine is basically invented by BMW it appeared in 2014 or so, and it replaced the former N20 models, which were also 2-liter, but those are based on the Prince engine, which was a joint development between PSA, now Stellantis, and the BMW, for use in any number of BMW small models, and especially for the Mini brand, and for French cars like Citroën, Peugeot, and whatever. So this is an all-aluminum engine, which has a plastic cover, and the block and the head are made of aluminum, and the plastic cover is there because you have a Valvetronic system. So when you press the accelerator pedal, you don't actually control the throttle plate. The throttle plate is active when the engine is during warm-up, and it closes partially because it needs to develop a little vacuum for the evap canister purge system to work. It's about these hoses that ventilate the fuel tank. But actually, when most of the times you press the accelerator pedal, you control the valve lift. So you have a small electrical motor on the head, which controls through an eccentric shaft how deep the intake valve go. So it means that when the engine is idling, you get about 0.2 millimeter opening. And when the engine is at full load, at top RPM, you get about 1 centimeter of opening. So that's around 10 millimeters. And it is all electrically connected. The system is called Valvetronic. But you also get variable valve timing on both camshafts, which are placed in the back, and that system is called Vanos, depends on the pronunciation. And the timing system has 3 chains. It used to have 4. So you have 1 chain for the variable displacement oil pump, and in the past they used to have actually 3 chains at first. So 1 for the oil pump and a 2-part timing chain that goes like a trolley like this for the upper part. That's because the diesel has the injection pump on that sprocket, whereas the gasoline does not have it, but they wanted to have a joint system between gasoline and diesels, because these engines have common parts between them. All gasoline and diesel engines, all sizes, are made on the same production line, so they use kind of all the pistons, injectors, spark plugs, and valves are common. So Toyota simplified the system because they have a partnership, and on new engines you will have more and more integration of the system. You have a double injection system, you'll have a twin scroll setup but with an integrated exhaust manifold in the head, which also this motor has, but this is only direct injected. And the timing has been simplified because you have only one upper chain. That means that the sprockets from the camshafts are different size, and you get the hydraulic actuators back in there. So, because it is direct injected, the exhaust camshaft acts on the fuel pump, which pressurizes fuel in a common rail, which also has a pressure sensor here. And you have solenoid injectors that are connected to this fuel rail. So it's a closed loop open system. It does not have a return a fuel line to the tank. And on the turbocharging side, you have a resonator here, because the air filter with the mass flow air sensor are in this box. And after the air gets filtrated and measured with that manifold sensor, the mass airflow sensor, sorry, it goes inside the turbocharger. The turbocharger uses an electrical wastegate, and this is a twin scroll design, but because this is a lower powered engine, lower output state, it has an integrated exhaust manifold in the head. So you get a turbo that has two pathways, like this one instead of four, as a normal B48 engine that is in a higher state, like the 306 horsepower one. And after the air gets compressed, it gets sent through a pipe diagonally up here through the intake manifold, where you have an intercooler, a charge air cooler that works on a separate heating and cooling circuit. So that's why you have two expansion tanks. This is for the engine, which also uses a normal water pump that's on the belt. And because this is a plug-in hybrid system, you don't have an alternator and an air conditioning compressor on that belt. All these systems are electrical, so you get an electrical air conditioning compressor. You also have a heat exchanger type condenser, not a radiator type one that is placed on the front. So the whole air conditioning unit resides here, and the heat is dissipated through a normal radiator up front with cooling liquid, with antifreeze and not with refrigerant. And because it is a short path of the turbocharged system, you have very high pressures and a very good throttle response. You also get electrical pumps for cooling the turbo and for cooling the intake manifold. And this means that there is a split cooling system. It is a high temperature system for the head and block. You have a split cooling valve, a diverter valve for the water pump that can recycle its own output so that it doesn't recirculate it through the radiator. You get a cooling valve that does not use a thermostat, so you get normal valves that are mechanically operated through electrical motors, so you don't get overheating problems with this engine. And the small loop circuit, which is lower temperature, has this water tank, another electrical pump, and it cools many things here. You have the inverter here, which is placed under this lid. You get the cooling for the electrical motor and also for the battery that are on that circuit. And this means that this car is way more complex than a normal one. And that electrical pump also recirculates the antifreeze through a separate low temperature radiator out front. And the engine has an interesting oil gallery for the oil piston cooling jets. The pistons are made from a hyperotectic aluminium, as it is called in English. Being direct injected is very efficient. Turbocharged twin scroll also, it clearly can develop more power than this, but it is compensated by the electrical motor in the transmission. You also get a particle filter down there, so it means it's an Euro 6D system, and the transmission lies after the engine. And also you get the transfer case from Magna, the Actimax system, sorry, which means that you have a clutch based on demand all-wheel drive, so the car will always be rear-wheel drive through a differential in the rear, and in the center one you don't have a differential, it's just a transfer case. And through a clutch pack connected to a chain, you have a front prop shaft that sometimes develops torque for the front axle. You also have heat exchangers for the engine oil, which is placed directly on the filter housing there. And you also get a kind of cooling for the gearbox, and some of them also have oil coolers for the gearbox, which implies a thermostat for their system and a natural circulation from the pressure pump from the transmission. So it's another more complicated system to make the car more efficient. And they use an old school braking system. The X6 is the first BMW that was designed to have an integrated braking system from Continental. They all rely on vacuum pumps because all have hydraulic engine mounts. So even if you have an electrical braking by wire system, you still get the vacuum pump for the engine mounts. This car, being an older model, like it's a 2021, it gets a vacuum styled booster, which is fed by that vacuum pump, which is a tandem pump with the oil pump, so it's driven by the timing out from the back. And you also get the connections for those hydraulic engine mounts. And it gets another interesting system, being a four-cylinder engine with a 2-liter capacity. It has two balancer shafts, Lanchester shafts, that rotate opposite one of each other at twice the speed of the crankshaft. So on one side you get one sprocket connected directly to the flywheel, and on the other side two sprockets, because you have to revert the spinning rotation direction of the second balance shaft. So this system kind of prevents that wobbling that four-cylinder large capacity engines have. So basically this is the mechanical part of the engine. I think it's a rather common engine now. It has some years and it's quite reliable because a lot of people have tuned their cars. It has some age under the hoods of basically every BMW model, and the suspension on this system, because it is based on an a 3 series or 4 series normal car, you have a McPherson strut with spring and the shock absorber, which can be electrically controlled by regard of the damping valve, and you get two separate lower arms, so it is like a two strut McPherson. And in the back you get a 5-link suspension. You have 3 links below and 2 links on the upper side, and it's called H5 by BMW, and it means that is a full independent suspension system. So dear people, this has been the X3, and mainly this is the architecture for kind of any German plug-in hybrid BMW from their offering, because they all use this parallel system, but some of them use larger capacity engines like the B58 in an X5 40E model, for example, or a 5 series. So you get a lot more power from that system, but the way it functions is similar because they are very modularly built. And another thing for the closure is that they get active flaps for cooling. So for example, now because the engine is switched off, you get this plastic system, so air does not enter the vehicle, it goes under it, so it means that it can consume less fuel this way. If you like this review, please join me in the comment section and I can respond to any of your questions, because I'm very passionate about the mechanics of these cars. I document myself on a very high level, so this means that I can really answer any technical questions regarding these cars. Bye bye!